Hello.
Drinks in New York City. Oh, you look so pretty. Think I fell in love before I even knew you.
It is my least favorite month of the year, purely because it is the hottest month of the year, but it does mean I get to wear sundresses, and you really can't complain about sundresses. Why don't we talk about the 21 books I read last month, which is ridiculous. I have no social life. But I guess that's excusable in the era of COVID-19. You're just like everybody else. Alrighty, let's get into it. The first novel that I read this month, I actually finished this month. I started it a while back, but that is Imaginary Friend by Stephen Chbosky. It is a chunker, as you can see. This novel is about a mother named Kate who has suffered abuse and her son Christopher. They're moving to a new town to kind of restart their lives. Well, while they're settling into their new home, Christopher mysteriously goes missing for 6 days. And when he comes back, he has no memory of what happened to him, and he's a little off. Something has changed a bit. John Green describes Stephen Chbosky's work as radiating this sort of radical empathy, and I think that is 100% correct. I've actually now finished the complete works of Stephen Chbosky. Video on that soon. I give this a 4 out of 5 stars, but totally recommend it if you're looking for a suspenseful, fun, really creative, imaginative read with very lovable characters. The next book I read this month was Having Our Say by the Delaney sisters. I have a video review on this, which I will link above and below. These two sisters go by the names Sadie and Bessie, and this is really a memoir, an account of their over 100 years on planet Earth. This book is not only an incredible account of these two women's lives, but it's also a really interesting way to look at how society has morphed and changed, specifically when it comes to social issues such as racism. They went through so much and they broke so many barriers and boundaries, and I'm just endlessly inspired by not only their successes, their failures, but also their just deep love for one another. They also say the key to longevity is not to get married, just in case you're wondering. Next, I read The Lovely War, maybe just Lovely War. I have such a hard time with that. This is a historical fiction romance, but it is told from the perspective of Greek gods and goddesses, including Aphrodite, Apollo, Ares, and Hades. I'm quite used to reading World War II historical fiction, and this was World War I, so I learned a lot, and it was really refreshing to learn more about a different time in history through a fictional lens. The characters in this book, you're rooting for them the whole time. They're all amazing, and I really love books where there's no one succinct and clear and obvious villain. I like when it's more vague and everyone is mildly morally gray, and in this book, society was really the villain. It also shows how love is really quite a deep emotion, and it's true love isn't superficial, and I quite enjoyed that about this book. I would definitely recommend. I finished this in like 2 sittings. So good. So good.
Magnificent.
It was Pride Month last month, so I read quite a few books surrounding the LGBTQ+ community with an emphasis on own voice authors. Now, I will say, something I have a problem with is when people say during Black History Month they'll read like 10 books featuring a Black character or by a Black author. That's awesome. But then they don't read any books by POCs for the rest of the year because they think they filled a quota. You know what I mean? Same thing goes with Pride Month. So the first book I read for Pride Month was Over the Top by the one, the only, Jonathan Van Ness Fabulous.
I love Queer Eye. I really, really, really love Queer Eye. The new season with the episode with the dog grooming lady. Oh my goodness, the doggy fashion show at the end of the week. I was, oh.
I actually read A Little Life because of Anthony. Anthony, why would you put me through that? Why would you do that to me? I was pleasantly surprised by this book. I wasn't expecting a ton just because I'd never associated Jonathan Van Ness with being a writer. But that's something really cool about reading and just the art form of the written word in general. Anyone can be a writer. There's no criteria. I was quite impressed with Jonathan's aptitude for not only the craft of writing, but also their really, really interesting story. They've had a really difficult life, but Jonathan always comes through at the end with a smiling face, and it might not always be an authentic smile, but they know they'll get there in the end, and it was just such an inspiring read. Eleanor Park, a novel by Rainbow Rowell. My friend Lily lent this to me. Thank you, Lily. I appreciate it to infinity and beyond, because this was a big deal when I was like 8. Eleanor and Park is a teenage love story, quite idealistic. Both characters have a difficult life in their own respective ways. It's cute, it's fluffy, it's very readable. That said, do I think it's going to age well? No. There's a lot of racism in this book, and I know that that's probably because the author is writing from the perspective of teenagers from an older time period that were insensitive and ignorant. But still, like, I don't see parts of this aging real well. No, I do not. Let me know your thoughts, because I think it's important to contextualize a book, realize when it was written, and not judge it too harshly by today's standards. But at the same time, I don't want to encourage people to read a book that is so outdated in its social awareness. Night by Elie Wiesel. This is Wiesel's account of his time in concentration camps during World War II. He was a young Jewish boy, and he was my age when he went through all of this. The desensitization that he suffered, the dehumanization. It's just astonishing. It's heartbreaking that people do this to other people. This is still happening, guys. There are concentration camps for Muslims in China. It's horror. I can't imagine the horrors in this book happening today, specifically because of the technological developments we have made. Like, imagine how much worse it could have been had it been now, and it is happening now. So I think it's important to look back on history to reflect on how we can do better in the future. Like I said in the vlog that I did for this, for my Compassio Verice readathon, it's not paced well. But that is the point, you know? The point is to be jarring. It's to shock you, but it's not just for the sake of shock value. This is the real story of the horrors and hatred that someone has encountered, and it's not gonna be a comfy read. And that's the point. Check this out, please. It will impact you forever. The Perks of Being a Wallflower by Stephen Chbosky. This book means a lot to me. Charlie, I see the world the way Charlie does. So I feel like I'm reading a book about me in a way, and I think that's a really high compliment to Stephen Chbosky, that he can write in a way that makes me feel as though this story is my life. The way that he looks at the world, the way he looks at the problems other people face, the way he approaches friendships, it's very, very similar to me. And because of that, I think it hits particularly hard. Charlie also struggles with mental health. I think it's really important to have books that show mental health being represented in a way that's not stigmatized or romanticized. And I think this book does a pretty good job of that. Mental illness is something that Charlie has to live with day by day, but it doesn't define his days. And I love that. The friendships in this book, A+. The family dynamic, super interesting. Big fan. Austin, thank you so much for this gift. This book changed my life. This is Little Fires Everywhere by the one, the only, the magnificent Celeste Ng. How to describe this book? Well, a mother named Mia and her daughter Pearl move into this very classic, stereotypical suburban area in Ohio. And the mother is an artist, and the daughter is kind of eclectic, super serious, very into studies, things like that. And they shake up the town a bit because the town is very rigid, very much so rule followers. This is how life is supposed to look. These are the milestones you have to hit. If you don't, you are failing, you are doing it wrong. Very judgmental community, you know? That's really the main premise of the story, is the way that Mia and Pearl interact with and affect the people around them. I really love Celeste Ng. I should have a Celeste Ng temple shrine in here somewhere. Those are all the physical books I read this month, but boy oh boy, you best bet I have 13 audiobooks. That's so sad. The first audiobook I listened to this month was With the Fire on High by Elizabeth Acevedo. This is about a high school senior named Imani. She dreams of being a culinary artist, not just a chef, an artist. And she has a daughter who she had when she was a freshman in high school. This novel not only deals with teenage pregnancy and teenage parenthood, but it also explores the main character Imani's heritage. She's African American, but she's half Dominican as well, and that's a big part of her identity. It also talks about following your dreams and really going after what you believe in, even if other people put you down. It explores familial relationships, it explores friendship relationships. There's like girl hate in here that resolves in a way that I thought was beautiful. Listen to the audiobook. Elizabeth Acevedo narrates it. She's a slam poet. Then I read Something Happened in Our Town by Marianne Solano. This is a children's book. I did listen to it on audiobook. This book explores from kind of an elementary student's perspective what happens in a town after an African-American man is shot dead for no reason. It discusses police brutality from the lens of really young people from multiple different demographics. The story itself was good. I think it's really going to be impactful for a child. It's very to the point, which is necessary oftentimes for young children, specifically if you're not getting any illustrations along with the narration. The really powerful part, though, were the resources provided at the end of the book. This is something every parent should read. It talks about how to approach racial discussions with your children, how racial discussions vary from demographic to demographic, how white parents don't talk to their kids about race because they have the privilege of not having that impact their everyday lives, whereas African American and Black parents have to have this conversation. It's not an option. It's not a luxury that they can afford. It's often a life or death matter. That was a 4 out of 5 star book. Then I read Black Klansman by Ron Stallworth. I have not seen the movie, which irks me to no end because Spike Lee, I love you. Also Adam Driver, big fan. Big fan of Adam Driver. Black Klansman is actually a true story. It is a memoir of Ron Stallworth, who is the first African-American police officer, at least in the narcotics unit, at the Colorado Springs Police Station. Black Klansman's really interesting. So essentially what happened, Ron Stallworth emailed a leader of the Ku Klux Klan. It was like, hey, I'm interested in joining. I want to know more info, like when can we meet? When can I be initiated? Of course, Ron Stallworth is a Black man, so there's kind of a problem here. He has to partner with one of his white peers, a white police officer, whose name I think is Chuck. Ron deals with all the stuff behind the scenes. He's there for the emails, the phone calls, the like, and then he fills in Chuck. And when Chuck has to go to a meeting or a rally as Ron, they think that Ron is white. It's crazy that this happened. This was a month of extreme Agatha Christie, so I'm gonna talk about the 3 Agatha Christie books I finished this month. The first one I read was The Murder on the Orient Express. I would just like to say that Dan Stevens, one of my favorite audiobook narrators of all time. So what happens is these people are all on a train. They're going to like Budapest or somewhere. Miles in Budapest, my hidden treasure chest. And then someone is murdered in cold blood. And no one can figure out who did it. Everyone has like a really reasonable alibi. Everyone seems totally uninvolved. It's a really tricky case, and there are a lot of red herrings to get past. Hercule Poirot, however, is a mastermind. He figures it out. It will shock you. Don't even try to guess, okay? Just wait till the big reveal. As far as book to movie adaptations go, definitely the worst one I have ever seen in my life. After that, I read And Then There Were None by Agatha Christie, narrated again by Dan Stevens. So these people are sent to a house on the middle of an island, and they all think it's for a different reason. One thinks she's like gonna be the new housemaid, another one is there just to meet with a friend, but really the letters were all sent from the same person. So they're all trapped in this house together, and slowly they're being killed off, and they cannot figure out who is doing it. They are alone on the island, so there's no way it could be anyone but themselves. So they're all killing each other pretty much, but you don't know who's killing who or if anyone is killing who. I was baffled. I had no idea. Like, how could this be happening? But then she explains it at the end, and you're like, oh, I get it. The last Agatha Christie piece I read this month was A Caribbean Mystery. It was cute. It was a Miss Marple mystery. Miss Marple's like this sweet old lady who really likes to solve crime. She's like a grandma vigilante.
Vigilante.
So these people are in the Caribbean at a really nice resort, and then someone
dies.
And then some more people
die.
And they all have to figure it out. There's kind of a trend here, murder mysteries, figuring it out, really confusing, you'd never guess it. Check it out. Next time I'm gonna read less books. This is kind of exhausting. Kid Activists by Robin Stevenson. This was about multiple activists throughout history, their childhoods, and how they grew up to be who they became. From Frederick Douglass to Dolores Huerta to Emma Watson. I mean, a number of people that were covered in this was so interesting. And I actually learned a lot of fun facts. I learned that Martin Luther King Jr. was a fashion badass. He had some game in the fashion world, which makes sense. He was always like very smartly tailored and everything. And this book really is trying to provide a window, a light into how even at a young age, people can begin to advocate for change, which is an important message specifically in 2020. Next, I read White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo. This was a quantitatively backed and qualitatively backed, actually, meditation on anti-racism in the modern world from the perspective of a white woman who works to incorporate diversity and anti-racism into corporations, businesses, and just community positions. Robin DiAngelo happens to be a sociologist, so she's coming from this with not only personal anecdotes, but also with a lot of evidence, which I think is really important and helpful to a lot of people. I watched a video a few days ago talking about how white people are reading a lot about the black experience and about anti-racism. But what are they learning? And that's such a good question. It's not enough to just like sit there and thumb through a book and be like, oh, that was good. 5 stars on Goodreads. Bravo. Everyone should read this book. It's another thing to really analyze what you're reading and synthesize it and evaluate it in a way that is applicable to your own life so that you as an individual can work towards making change. Some big takeaways for me personally from this book were the ideas of, one, white women's tears. I thought that was super interesting. I'd actually never heard of that before. Maybe I live under a rock, but it made so much sense, and it wasn't something I'd considered before. I also learned a lot about white privilege. I obviously knew it was a thing. I've always known it was a thing, but I didn't know in depth really how it worked. And really, the epitome of white privilege, just in a really simplistic, generalized way, is if you do not have to think about your race and how it will impact you on a daily basis. I never had a conversation about my race with my parents. Did my sister? Yeah, she's adopted from China. She's had that conversation, so I've witnessed that, but it's never something that's been applicable to me as Maya, as just me, because I am white. African American parents, Latino parents, etc., they don't have the privilege of not discussing race with their children because it's something that will not only likely impact them every single day, but something that, again, could be a life or death matter. Then I read The Honey Don't List by Christina Lauren, because sometimes you gotta have a fluffy rom-com. There's this couple that does a home renovation show, kind of like Chip and Joanna Gaines, okay? But the difference here is that they hate each other. Like, the wife and the husband, no, not happening. But they just released a book about having the ideal marriage, and they're about to go on a book tour, and they hate each other, and she just found out that he's cheating, so now they hate each other an extra little smidge more. So, to keep them in check on their publicity tour, they have their assistants come with them on the tour. The assistants were supposed to have like the week off, but no. Now they are babysitters. This was so fun, not only because like the assistants fall in love, obviously, and they're cute together, and they're fun characters on an individual level, but because just the amount of melodrama between the fixer-upper home show couple, it was amazing. It was the way, it was so well written. I was entertained throughout. I'd recommend it. I then read The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander. I was inspired to read this after watching 13th, which is a documentary on Netflix written, directed, everything by Ava DuVernay that talks a lot about anti-racism. This book was very interesting. I learned a lot statistically about the prison system, how it works disproportionately against people of color, specifically the black community in America, and how the drug war, kind of initiated by Ronald Reagan, continued by Bill Clinton, etc., really pushed the way that our prison system works. Now, I learned how difficult it is to get a house, to get a job, to pay for your family, to support the people in your life after prison. Really, prison, it doesn't just take up 5 years of your life, let's say. It takes up all of your life because you're always associated with it. If you are branded a felon, segregation is okay. The New Queer Conscious by Adam Eli. Again, this was a book I read for Pride Month to learn a little more, to keep supporting a community, and just to celebrate the month. This was a really interesting book. It was kind of halfway memoir, halfway call to action, and I found it very, very, very impactful, not only because it discusses LGBTQ+ rights, but also because it does so in a way that really analyzes and engages with intersectionality. Adam Eli is not only a gay man in the United States, but he is also Jewish. So he faces a lot of discrimination and bias on multiple different levels. And he also discusses how he is privileged in comparison to people of color within the LGBTQ+ community. I found it really inspiring. He has a very beautiful vision for the way that the world will work and the way that people can grow and learn to love and accept one another that I found really, it was just heartwarming. It was very short. I think it was like an hour long audiobook, and I learned a lot. I was inspired by his own experiences, and his call to action was quite profound. I'd recommend it. I read the worst book I've read all year this month. That is Naomi and Eli's No Kiss List by Rachel Kahn and David Leviathan. So I thought, you know what, I'll give it a shot. It has kind of an average rating on Goodreads. May as well. Oh man, I gave this a 1.5 out of 5 stars. 1, because it sucked. 2, because the character sucked. 3, because the writing style sucked. 4, I'll just tell you my primary reason. I want you to have your own opinion. Don't be too swayed by me. But, so essentially Naomi and Eli are best buds. And the main conflict in this book is that Naomi is sad that Eli will never love her the way she loves him because he has chosen to be gay. She comes to realize this isn't true, but really, throughout the entirety of the book, she's like, I can't believe that he couldn't put aside his gayness for 1 hour to, like, kiss me. What? Sexuality isn't a choice. The last book I read this month happens to be the longest book I have read so far this year, clocking in at 913 pages. That is A Clash of Kings by George R.R. Martin. This is the second book in the Song of Ice and Fire series, so I'm not gonna go into it too much. I don't want to give anything away. I will say, George R.R. Martin's writing style is very consistent, and that's actually something I really appreciate in a fantasy series, because then I kind of know what to expect stylistically, but he takes me on a journey creatively that I wasn't anticipating.
The characters, again, I love them.
Those are all of the 21 books I read in the month of June 2020. Thank you so much for watching this video, everyone. Feel free to like and subscribe if you feel so inclined. If not, have a wonderful day. I'll be back next time. I post videos every Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, and Sunday. And until then, I will say adieu.